In part 3 of our lesson on the inverse circular functions, you will learn about the inverse cosine function. Let's start off with the graph of y equals cosine of x. And just like we discovered with the graph of sine of x, cosine is not 1-to-1 because it fails the horizontal line test. If we put a horizontal line through the function, it would hit the graph in infinitely many points over time. So we will need to restrict the domain to make it 1-to-1. And the standard is to choose a section of the graph closest to the origin so that the graph will pass the horizontal line test and yet still yield every possible y value in the range. Now we know that the range of this cosine graph is from negative 1 to positive 1. So we cannot pick the same x values that we picked for sine. Remember that for the sine graph, we went from negative pi over 2 to positive pi over 2. Now, if we made that same choice here for the cosine graph, then we would only get y values from 0 to 1. So we would be missing half of the y values. So then the choice here is we can start at x equals 0 and go to x equals pi. So that's what we will restrict the domain to. So we are going to pick this portion of the graph from 0 to pi. And like we did for the sine graph, let's find some easy to plot points here that we can use to create the inverse cosine graph. It starts off here at 0, 1, then here is an easy one to plot at pi over 3, comma 1/2. Next, we have pi over 2, 0. Here, we have 2 pi over 3, negative 1/2. And finally here, we have pi, negative 1. So we'll use these 5 points to create our graph of inverse cosine. So the point 0, 1 on the graph of cosine becomes the point 1, 0 on the graph of inverse cosine. Pi over 3, 1/2 on the graph of cosine becomes 1/2 pi over 3 on the graph of cosine inverse. Pi over 2, 0 becomes 0 pi over 2 on cosine inverse. On the cosine graph, we have 2 pi over 3, negative 1/2. So on cosine inverse, that will become negative 1/2, 2 pi over 3. And finally, on the cosine graph, we had pi, negative 1, so that will become negative 1 pi. And here's what this curve looks like. So there's our entire graph of cosine inverse of x. Notice the direction of the curves is the opposite of the cosine graph, and that's because of the reflection over the line y equals x. Now let's look at the domain and range of this graph. We know that the domain is all the x values that are allowed. So it starts at negative 1 and goes up to positive 1. And the range is going to be the resulting y values. So the smallest y value we have is at this first point here, and that's 0. And then the y values go up until it gets to a maximum value of pi. So the range is going to be 0 to pi. Now this is a big difference from the sine inverse graph. If you remember, the range of sine inverse was negative pi over 2 to positive pi over 2. Notice that cosine inverse has no negative output values. All of its output values in its range are positive from 0 to pi. So that is a big difference between cosine inverse and sine inverse. And just a reminder, cosine inverse is a one-to-one function. And we've discussed that before. We know that means that every x maps onto only one y, and every y maps onto only one x. This graph passes the vertical line test, and it passes the horizontal line test. Therefore, cosine inverse is 1-to-1. Now, as we did with sine and inverse sine, you can think of cosine and inverse cosine like machines. We know that the machine called cosine will be input with its domain, and in this case, the restricted domain. It will be input angles from 0 to pi, and it will output its range of real numbers from negative 1 to 1. So then that means the machine called inverse cosine, when we input its domain, it's going to have to be real numbers from negative 1 to 1, and it will output its range of angles, and those angles have to be from 0 to pi. And that comes right from the graph of cosine inverse. When we look at that graph, all the y values fall between 0 and pi. There are no negative y values anywhere on the graph of cosine inverse. We can switch between the inverse function form and the trig function form. To say that theta equals cosine inverse of x means that we can write it that cosine of theta is equal to x. In this case, we would take the cosine of both sides, and that equation would simplify to cosine theta equals x. Now remember, the domain for cosine inverse of x means we will be inputting real numbers from negative 1 to 1, and what cosine inverse of x will output is its range, which are angles from 0 to pi. And just like we had for sine inverse, we have an alternate notation for cosine inverse, which is called arc cosine of X, and we will use that this semester and in calculus and beyond. So now we're ready to evaluate some exact cosine inverse function values, making use of this relationship between cosine inverse and cosine. In this example, we have to give each exact value. First up, we have the cosine inverse of 1/2. Now we know that cosine inverse of a real number is going to output an angle. So it's some angle, let's call it theta. Now, if we have this form, we can turn it into this form. So applying that to this first example, we get that cosine of theta would have to equal 1/2. Now remember the limitation you have on the range. The angle theta has to be between 0 and pi. So now what you do is think of an angle between 0 and pi where the cosine of that angle would equal 1/2. And the only angle for which that is possible is pi over 3. And if we take a look at the graph of the inverse cosine function, you can see if we input 1/2, then the graph is going to output pi over 3. There's only one possible answer. There's no other answer that's possible. And that's because cosine inverse is 1:1. And a quick reminder that this is very different than the cosine function. The cosine function has many angles for whom the cosine would be 1/2, and that's because the cosine function is not 1:1. For example, we know that the cosine of pi over 3 is 1/2. We also know that the cosine of 5 pi over 3 is 1/2. Now that works on the cosine graph because cosine is not 1:1. That will never work on cosine inverse because cosine inverse is 1:1. The only output value we could get for 1/2 is pi over 3. All right, why don't you try this next one, cosine inverse of negative 1/2. So pause the video, try it on your own, and then restart the video when you're ready to check your answer against mine. We know that cosine inverse of negative 1/2 is going to output an angle, so we'll call it theta. And we can rewrite that in this form where cosine of theta has to equal negative 1/2. Now you have to remember the limitation on the range for theta. The angle that gets output has to be between 0 and pi. So the only angle that's between 0 and pi whose cosine of that angle would be negative 1/2 is 2 pi over 3. And now let's take a look at that on the graph of cosine inverse. If we input an x value of negative 1/2, you can see that the function is going to output an angle of 2 pi over 3. Go ahead and try these last two. So pause the video and then restart when you're ready to check your answers. Here we have a cosine inverse of 1. We know that is going to be an angle, and we can rewrite this as cosine of theta has to equal 1. We know that theta must be between 0 and pi for cosine inverse. So the only angle between 0 and pi whose cosine is 1 is 0. Now if we look at the graph of cosine inverse, we can see it right there. If you go to an input value of 1, then the output value is 0. Here we have the cosine inverse of negative radical 3 over 2. We know that the output of a cosine inverse function is an angle. We can rewrite this equation as cosine theta has to equal negative radical 3 over 2. We know that for cosine inverse, that angle has to be between 0 and pi. The only angle between 0 and pi where the cosine of that angle would be negative root 3 over 2 is at 5 pi over 6. We can check this one out on the cosine inverse graph. Input the negative root 3 over 2, and you can see the function is going to output 5 pi over 6. And that is the one and only possible answer.